You are listening to KZYX 90.7 FM Philo, KZYZ 91.5 FM Willits and Ukiah, 88.1 FM Fort Bragg. Altogether, we make up Mendocino County Public Broadcasting, member-supported community radio. We also stream live on the web at kzyx.org. Support for KZYX comes from our members and Al Punto Spanish newspaper. Al Punto is Mendocino County's local paper dedicated to the Latinx community, featuring the latest news, events, education, and immigration information. More online at periodicalalpunto.com. Hi, and welcome to Be More Now. My name is Blake Moore, and tonight, once again, I'm interviewing Mendocino County artist Lauren Sinnott. In a blend of painting, process, and artistic discovery, we're going to be discussing Lauren's bright life and colorful contributions to the county's urban landscape, including her most recent mural edition, her From Finland to Fort Bragg mural project in Fort Bragg. But first, for a little added inspiration, is the bare naked ladies doing drawing.
There's a blueberry pancake flying in the sky. I can see it. I can see it. And there's a castle in the cloud and it's floating on by. Can you see it? Can you see it? With my imagination.
I can see it.
With my pencil crayons.
I can draw it.
On a piece of paper.
I can show it to you.
I can show it to you. There's a flipper hippopotamus riding on a bike. I can see it. I can see it. There's a spaceship over my house at night. I just know it. I just know it. With my imagination.
I can see it.
With my pencil crayons.
I can draw it.
On a piece of paper.
I can show it to you.
I can show it to you.
That's right.
Draw. Draw.
Draw.
Na 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 na. Draw.
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 Na 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 na.
Na 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 na. Na 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 na. Na 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 na.
My imagination. My imagination. My pencil crayons. My imagination.
Drawing was released in 2016. It comes from the Bare Naked Ladies album, Red Rocks Live. The album artwork and just the creativity of their work is definitely something that fits with my next guest, Lauren Sinnott. And I know many of us in the county are familiar with her and her work because she did the Ukiah History mural. I'd like to share some biographical background on Lauren Sinnott before I bring up that conversation. Resident of the southern Mendocino Coast since 1998, Lauren Sinnott is a working artist in an old world manner. She paints pictures that are full of pattern and decoration, but also tells stories, often with portraits. She says she makes things that regular people need, like businesses, signs, logos, and even a high school mascot on the basketball court floor. She learned to sew from her mom and grandmother, which she says is always useful, not just to make her own clothes and create the velvet vulva line of purses, but also to hem pants and take prom dresses in. She grew up in Wisconsin's Dairyland in a creative beatnik home. Her mom was an artist and illustrator, and she copied her from before she was two. An exchange year abroad in Belgium shaped her. There's really good coffee in the world, she says, and houses that are 400 years old. At Rice University in Houston, she got the training necessary to shape talent in painting, but also in art history. Her master's degree focused on the Renaissance and exposed her to art that was full of meaning, held symbols, had inscriptions, and told stories that people with a shared culture understood. That's what she aims for now, using her sons and the people around her to populate the painted stage. Her newest history mural, From Finland to Fort Bragg, illustrates the rich heritage of the many Finnish immigrants to this coastal Northern California town. Here's the conversation we had earlier this week.
Lauren Sinnott, it is so nice to have you with me once again on Be More Now. Thank you for being here.
Thank you so much for the invite. I always say that art needs an audience, and so it's always wonderful to get on our beloved community radio and talk about it so people can know what's going on and know where they can go see it.
Right. Well, you just finished another big project, right?
I did. Luckily, it didn't take 4 years.
Well, you didn't have fires and a pandemic. You had a relatively quiet time painting this one, right?
It was. Yeah, and it's quite a bit smaller. I mean, in like normal terms, people wouldn't call it small, but compared to the big one in Ukiah, it's smaller. So it was actually the dentist, Alan Limbird, who practices and lives up on the North Coast. He practices in Fort Bragg. He had seen the big mural in Ukiah, and he said, oh, my gosh, you know, he's an art patron. He's one of the people who takes part in the Alleyways Arts Project up in Fort Bragg. And he has several buildings, so he has not only allowed his buildings to be painted on, but then he's put up some of the money, the sponsorship for it, for a couple of projects at least, mine and the one that it's right next to. So he saw the mural in Ukiah, and he said, I want you to do the one in my next one in Fort Bragg. And it's right downtown. And I don't want to go on and on. You might want to ask specifics. But it turned out to be so cool because it's right next to one by Bo Parker, which is, I think, sort of famous because it's really visually impactful. It's very stylized. It's called Matsya and the Great Deluge. And it's right on, basically on, the sidewall of a building on North Franklin, 300 block of North Franklin. And so mine was going to be right next to his, and it is. And it was just neat because I really love his, but also I got to use my different but also highly stylized and decorative style right next to his. And I worked intentionally on the right side of it, right next to him, to blend it in and to harmonize, you know, like to sort of make some of his come over into mine. It's sort of cool that way.
Kind of like the Brickell District of Miami, if you've ever been there, where there's just blocks and blocks of murals, and they're all
kind of
one going to the other.
Oh, that's neat. I haven't been there. I should.
Oh, you would love that. Yeah, that's a really amazing scene. It's kind of like the, you know, the alleyway Presida Eyes, where they have a couple of the alleys in the Mission District of San Francisco, really cool alleyways where you can just get lost, and it's one after another after another. So, I've always been a big proponent of outdoor art, you know, art that's forever. And for the most part, that a lot of the, especially in Miami, they weren't tagged. So there's a respect, street artist respect that happens.
I think that's true. I don't want to, you know, push my luck, but I have felt that also. Mm-hmm. Like with a big mural in Ukiah, it's coded, but, you know, a lot of harm could be done, and I think the graffiti artists have chosen not to do that. And
yeah.
I give them
There's
respect,
plenty of other
and
walls.
I'm really grateful.
So when did you finish your mural in Fort Bragg?
It was finished on Halloween. I went back after Halloween to do the coating, but I finished on Halloween. I was, you know, I thought I was done the night before, but I had not. I finished sort of in the dark. And so
on Halloween, how perfect is that?
Well, sort of in the dark the night before, but then on Halloween I managed to finish in the afternoon and rush back home and get here in time to give apples from Oz out to half of the trick-or-treaters. So it was good. It was perfect to finish on Halloween.
And did you wear a costume while you were painting your last day of Halloween on Halloween?
My costume is my weird clothes.
You're always in costume, yes.
Yeah, and in this one, this was later, you know, I had thought maybe I could do it early in the summer, but there were a lot of things that came up, so I ended up painting in mostly, I think I started in August, it's September, October, and it had gotten chilly, and so I was wearing my Canadian Sorel, you know, snow boots and big socks and, you know, all the stuff to stay warm. There were some days when it was really cold because it's foggy up there. It's not like Ukiah, at least you'd be cold, but you'd be in the sun.
Do you find that the fog can interfere with your dry time of the paint, dripping or any of that kind of thing that you had to deal with when it starts getting goopy like that?
A little. Like one day it actually turned into fog rain, and so I just couldn't paint. And in general, it interferes a little bit, but you just have to I use house paint, so it's it's designed to dry. And so you just have to be careful. Don't bump into it. Don't, like, spill your coffee. Just wait a little bit longer. But you're right, it does affect it.
I paint murals on my walls and outside, and I've had really pushing it to the end of the day and then come out in the morning and, you know, that blue Buddha face has a drip going all the way down to the grass, you know.
Yes. And, I have done that before because I always push it too. But maybe I have, in my later years, learned. I don't know.
Yes.
The drip thing hasn't happened in recent years, but I know exactly what you mean. You wake up the next morning and you're like, oh, no.
Exactly. So with this mural, it's on Franklin Street. You said the 300 block. That's between what and what?
Yeah, I will tell you. It's between Redwood and Laurel.
And
it's on the west side. So if you're on the 300 block of North Franklin, you're right in the middle. You're standing in front of Racine's, you know, art supply store. Uh-huh. And look west, and there's a mini alleyway, like a side alley, going to the main alley that's through this big block that has, like, Headlands Cafe on it and that wonderful Italian restaurant on the north side. But anyway, you're on Franklin Street. Look west from Racine's and walk down that little bitty alleyway, and you'll see Beau's wonderful mural first on your right, and then mine is right next to it on your right.
Are there any street photos of them? Like, do you have any pictures that I could link to or something? I mean, not everyone is listening, lives in Fort Bragg or is on the coast, so it's not as easy to get to. Yeah.
Yeah, Blake, it's all, it's completely on my website. I put it on historymural.com. And so if you go to historymural, the two words put together, .com, you'll find it in the menu, but also I can just tell people it's at www.historymural.com/finn. F-I-N-N slash. And that's the homepage of the new mural, and then there are about 5 or 6 subpages. Yeah, they can see the whole thing.
The whole thing. Great. So why Finland? Why did you, what was the inspiration for this mural?
So it was cool because I think I'm not alone in either people forgetting or, in my case, not ever knowing what a huge impact the Finnish immigrants had on Fort Bragg and how many there were. There were, according to my research, they were the biggest national group of immigrants to that area. And you know how down here, I think it would probably be the Italians as far as the biggest single group from a nation or Italian Americans. But up there it was the Finns. There were a lot of Portuguese too, but the Finns were the most numerous. And this happened late 1800s, early 1900s. And, you know, I mean, people totally integrated. Their names are everywhere up in Fort Bragg now, but one doesn't think about it, and relative newcomers like me didn't know. And so I was just researching Fort Bragg. You know, I wanted to do history because that's the most fun, and it's really wonderful to keep history alive through imagery that engages people. And I got the green light from the city and from Alan Lindbergh, the dentist whose building that is, to, you know, pick your subject, and definitely didn't want to do some of the subjects that have been, you know, repeated over and over and also aren't totally inspiring, like logging. I mean, logging was important. It's a big deal, but I find the redwoods incredibly inspiring. But, you know, I mean, so maybe I could paint the redwoods. I thought about that. They're hard to paint, though, because they're so giant. I always end up painting just the massive trunks. But, so I'm doing research on the history, and I read about a consumer co-op that was started in 1923 by the Finnish immigrants, and it was just that one sentence that led me into this subject, and then I found out what a big deal this was, how many they were, and what rich cultural, I would call it heritage or gifts, you know, what amazing attributes they brought to the community. So it was perfect, perfect subject matter.
So can you talk about some of the things? Because I think a lot of us, I mean, I didn't realize that there was a Finnish connection to Fort Bragg. And
I know.
Yeah.
Right? Yes. So they came, a lot of them came, so we're talking about the later 1800s and then the early 1900s. There was a lot of upheaval, you know, in Finland. They were fleeing the Russia. In the early 1800s, Russia had taken the place of Sweden in dominating and sort of claiming Finland. And Russia, Tsarist Russia, was starting to, some, I forgot which wars they were in, but they were drafting people. Sound familiar? And they were drafting people from Finland, and a lot of these people didn't, you know, didn't identify with Russia, didn't identify with these wars, and did not want to go fight them. So many of them fled for that reason. And then also, of course, there were, you know, like economic opportunities here. They had a lot of experience with fishing and logging. And so they came here for that. And then in the early 1900s, you get Finland. So it's dominated by Russia. Russia undergoes the revolution, the communist revolution, and they recognize Finland as an independent nation, which is awesome. But then, and I should have read up on this a little bit more, but basically there was, subsequent to that, then there was pressure, more and more pressure from Russia, and people fled that too. And so you get a lot of people from Finland that, you know, they're looking for economic opportunity, but they have certain characteristics that are common, if not to all, to many. They're very self-sufficient, and not just for themselves. It seemed like they didn't want to just live out in the woods, you know, and make my little homestead and just get everything I need for me, and that's it. They were really community-oriented. So they wanted to create self-sufficiency, but they wanted it for the town. They wanted Fort Bragg to be self-sufficient. And so there's, you know, a lot that can be said about that, but that's why they started the co-op, because prior to that, people would mostly shop at the lumber company, the company store, you know, and people, sometimes workers even got paid in credits at the store, which would keep you shopping at the store. And so you were sort of tied to that one store, and you didn't have other choices, and maybe it was too expensive in some ways. And so they wanted to create competition and create a store that gave you the best prices. So it wasn't for profit, and therefore they wanted to do a co-op. And they thought of it early. There was this huge co-op movement in the United States in like the early 1900s. And they thought of it then, but they realized they couldn't get their goods to Fort Bragg other than by the lumber companies and railroads, right? Like they were tied. There was this one method of transporting goods, and it was going to be expensive. And those the railway and the timber company weren't going to give them good prices because they were competition, and they didn't want that. And so they had to wait until trucking, I guess, you know, like highways and trucking got reasonable enough that they could transport things that way. So by 1923, they could start this, and they did their own transport. And so they took, and I know I'm going way off into the co-op, but this sort of ties in with these
characteristics. It's interesting, yeah.
Yeah, so they found at this time they could do their own transport, so they would bring goods in cheaper, as you know, as reasonably priced as they could. And then they would take people's goods out. Like, there were a lot of people who had chickens and could raise, you know, provide eggs for market. And they would take them down to a bigger market. Like, you could sell them in Fort Bragg, but a lot of people had chickens, so the market was sort of saturated up here. And so they took their chickens down to Petaluma, to the bigger market. So you could sell and you could buy at good rates. And this was really, you know, totally in line with what the Finns wanted to do. They wanted to help each other and help the community and be self-sufficient and, like, make it so everybody could make a living. And they were, the last thing I'll say on that one attribute of theirs is they were often, whether they were closely linked to socialists and even communism or not, they were very oriented towards respect for work. You know, it's not just the boss who deserves respect. All the workers deserve respect. And it was, like, it's a really cool, awesome story.
I just want to take a quick moment, remind you, you're listening to Be More Now, right here on KZYX. I'm your host, Blake Moore, and I'm in conversation with muralist who lives in Point Arena, Lauren Sinnott. We're talking about her recently completed Fort Bragg mural, From Finland to Fort Bragg.
Wow, that's interesting. It's funny, there's a town up in British Columbia on across the Queen Charlotte Strait on a little island. It's a town called Soyantula, and it's in...
Yes?
Yeah, and they're also a little Finnish. They were a Finnish utopia that a friend of mine was raised there, and his parents, his grandparents were part of the, you know, his family had been part of the founding of it. And
yes.
They were, yeah, they were, you know, the saunas and the fisher people and a lot of poets. I used to go, and I spent a couple of, you know, 6 weeks at a time up there during the winter, and you know, you go from the sauna to the ocean, and they call it the saltcha. The saunas that were, you know, 13, 14 people in a sauna, and it was what you did every day. It's just part of life, and it's how you stay warm and everything else. So I feel like I got a little touch of that in that town.
Absolutely. Blake, when did you do that? When were you going up there?
Early 2000s, you know, late.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
It's totally the same spirit,
yeah.
And there, and we'll probably get into this, but there was a Soyantula here, too, I mean, outside of Fort Bragg.
Oh, really?
And yes, it means place of harmony.
Yeah.
And there were people, and what you said is exactly right. They were trying to create, the word utopia is sort of strong, but they wanted to create ideal places that were mm-hmm. great, right? Like what you just described is wonderful.
Oh, it was an amazing place. I had such an incredible experience there. And I was so welcomed by everybody. And by no means by, you know, it was on Malcolm Island, and it was still a relatively small community, but it was not all finished by that point. And
right.
There was a strong interaction with the native peoples. So, you know, it kind of, it aligns with maybe what some people say about the Russian traders, that when they came into the areas, you know, they weren't burn and run kind of people. You know, it wasn't, mm-hmm. There was a little bit more cooperation with the native cultures. So it allowed for, and I'm not sure what the case is in Fort Bragg, you know, where that lies on the stealing of land barometer. But I do think that I know for sure up there, there was a lot of cooperation, and the town was pretty integrated on that level.
Yes, it's so inspiring. It's really cool to hear about that, even like in the 80s, being that way and persisting, you know, and
yeah, this is the 2000s, so this was in like 2000.
Oh, yeah, 2000s,
yeah.
Right.
Yeah,
well,
yeah.
I can briefly tell you about the one outside of Fort Bragg, somewhat different, but it's exactly that same impulse to create like a beautiful, harmonious, cooperative, beneficial place to be. The Soyantula in outside of Fort Bragg, it's like 7 to 8 miles southeast. And
okay.
There were four families. You know, people wanted to own land, but you couldn't. Many people worked in the logging industry or were fishermen, and you didn't have that much money. And so four families decided to go in together to buy land out there, and it was 600 plus acres logged over, really steep. You know, they said there was just enough flat land to put your hat down, or the other saying was it was all either uphill or downhill. Anyway, it was logged over, and together they bought it, and the four families moved out, and they, you know, they had quite a few kids each. I think at 10 years later, there are maybe 24 kids out there, and they, at the beginning, made the mortgage by, you know, they, well, to backtrack just a tiny bit, you can farm, you can have gardens, you can have flocks, you can do your thing for yourself, but it's fairly hard to make a living that way. Even then, partly because this is such steep land, it's so full of redwood roots. And so at the beginning, they paid their mortgage making railroad ties out of the stumps. Because the stumps, this is old growth redwood, the stumps are giant, you know, so you could get 10-foot lengths out of them. And they hand-hewed railroad ties. And so that, Sointila is in the mural. It's on the right. If your listeners will look at the website, they'll see it under the subhead called Families. And for the four families that settled there were the Jacobsons, the Mankinens, the Ericksons, and, oh, my God, the Andersons. It's so terrible. The fourth name. But four families, you know, they're still around, many of them, and not the original founders, of course, but I had this awesome photo of the founding families 10 years after the founding, and they founded it in 1904, I'm pretty sure. And so 10 years later, they took this cool picture of all the people and their kids, and I painted that whole group into the mural. And it was cool because there are descendants now. Like, one is Sylvia Bartley, who's involved with the Historical Society up there. Her dad is one of the kids in there. And she spent a lot of her childhood up there and has incredibly fond memories of it. And another cool thing about the portraits is, unbeknownst to me, you know, like two of the kids and other kids in the portrait got married. There are all these little links that you find later. And just to finish up that description, they had, of course, they had a sauna, and they said that would often be the first thing that you built because you need to bathe. You could live in it while you're building all the rest of the stuff. And it was social. The sauna was, it's a way to make bathing into a party is what I ended up realizing.
Yep, that's exactly right.
Right? You're doing it with people. And so there's that aspect of communication and community in a really honest setting, I think, when you have all your clothes off somehow.
Well, yeah, and the thing about it, too, is it's authentic in that it doesn't matter that you're naked. You know, no one really, no one cares. So there's not, the self-consciousness is not, embedded in this action. And that, for me, it was really, I also was in Japan. I moved to Japan in the late 80s, and experienced communal bathing in Japan because I lived in a place that I didn't have my own shower, so I had to go to the Asento down the street. And I was in a suburban neighborhood of Tokyo, and I experienced these, you know, I walked in and nobody looked like me, and no one spoke what I spoke, and I had some ladies take me around and show me how to do it. And it was so, at first, I didn't like it. I'm like, yo, just get away. I'm trying to, I know how to shower. Don't, like, leave me alone. And then I kind of leaned in. And then at the very end, one of them came, this is my very first experience, and one of them came and just doused me with cold water. And it was, you know, March in Tokyo, so it was cold outside. And I came out of my skin, and they, you know, I was so mad, and they just laughed at me. They just laughed, and they, you know, managed to convey that by sealing it, you know, your pores with the cold water, you'll be warm longer. And it was true. I stopped being cold after that experience. So I literally learned how to keep my, I learned about cold showers, the Wim Hof method that everyone talks about now in Tokyo in the 80s because I had to communally bathe, right?
Oh my gosh. Yes. It is such an awesome experience. And then they would have a little, they always had refreshments after, you know, like often coffee, and it had to be hot. which I love, and some like braided bread, which is called pula, and or they might have beer and sausages and various things. But it was just a gathering, right? And you know, it's so awesome that it made it,
right.
It was a way to bathe using the resources they had and their traditions,
and
it builds community. So, yeah, so Sointila was, they, of course, had a little sauna. I know how to say it.
Sauna.
I didn't say it. Sauna.
Is Sointila, is it gone? What happened to that?
So it is sort of sad. I mean, it's sort of like when people say they had a failed marriage. It wasn't, you know, not necessarily failed. It was great for the period of time that it was there. And so it was great for the period of time it was there, which was about 50 years. And then at that point, so you're talking 50 years later, those founders would be old, probably some passed away at that point, and quite old. I've seen pictures of, you know, like Sylvia's dad, Oscar, and as a much older man there. But the younger generation often, you know, would almost all, I believe, would go into town to get jobs, perhaps move away, you know, join the modern economy. And then by the time you get to the grandparents, I mean the grandkids level, you know, they're mostly not going to be living out there. So it was that kind of attrition. And then they decided at a point to sell it. And the sad thing, and Sylvia told me this, she's written about it too in one of the Historical Society publications, it was bought by another logging company, and they just, you know, decimated it. They tore down the houses, the sauna, and it started cutting more because now you had greater, you know, before the big trees were cut, hand sawn, I believe, like around 1900, and now you had chainsaws and all of this technology that they could go further and cut more. And she said when she went out there, it was just sort of devastating. But it still can't take away the history of what happened there and the, you know, what it, the way it formed the people that lived there and their community. And they, here's something really cool to add to Sointila. It was out, I'll get the river right. It's out on one of the forks of the Noyo River, right? And their communities all, not towns, but like groups of farms out there. And the Finns built a lot. Like if they needed a hall, they built it. If they needed a school, they built it. So they built a school out there because you're talking 7 miles, and this is in the day of buggies, and also during the winter, sometimes the river couldn't be crossed, and you're not going to come into Fort Bragg to go to school. So they built the school, and it was on, as far as Sointila goes, it was on the other side of the Noyo, and or Cass Creek, perhaps, I think, feeding into the Noyo. And so they built a suspension bridge that was hooked to giant redwood stumps on either side, and so the kids would walk across the suspension bridge to go to school, and they built a hall over there so those people would get together on Saturdays and, you know, have a sauna and get together and have some goodies and have music. That was the other thing they did so much of, music, because, you know, what better way to have fun and dance?
Right. Gather together. Yeah.
Yeah. So nothing can take that history away, even though Sointila is not there, but a lot of people do still live in the area, like Sylvia and her husband live in another area close to Fort Bragg, not too far from there, out on 20. Yeah.
So there's like a little piece of it, but it's no longer. What year did they finally have to give it up?
It was, I think, 1956.
56.
Like it was in the 50s, I'm pretty sure. Yeah, and that's been written up too. I can send you some of these references after, if like you post on the website, the radio station website, we can guide your listeners to some of these accounts.
Yeah, I'm seeing this and looking at your website. You talk about, you know, that they created a Finnish arm of the American Socialist Party, and they had concerts and balls and voting events and all sorts of things. It's very interesting. And would you say that some of the family are, you know, you said there's real people in the mural. Are some of the families in the mural still here?
Yes, so their descendants are here.
Uh-huh.
And actually some of the people in the mural are still here, and that could, like Sylvia, who I mentioned, you know, her on the right side of the mural there, I painted that whole group of the Sonchila founders and their many kids. And I met a woman came up while I was working and said, "That's my great-grandpa." So the Jacobson father in the mural, it was her great-grandpa, and we found where her dad is in there. So then I met her. Sylvia not only is her father and mother in there with their kid, her dad, Oscar, but I put her in this thing that I love to do by compressing time or putting people from different times together. I put her next to Eddie Menkinen, who is another one of the kids, as a little girl, you know, like just bigger than a toddler, and he's a little boy. And they used to play out there and hold hands, and he told her he would be her husband or marry her one day, and, you know, all that classic stuff.
So
Eddie and Sylvia are in there as kids. And then one of the other people that I met who worked with me a lot and was an awesome source of information and just great conversation about the Finnish heritage and his own life, because he's one of their descendants, is David Mackey, and he's part of the Historical Society as well, and that's spelled M-A-K-I. It's the Finnish name Mackey. His grandma is in there, and he had this awesome picture of her having gone fishing, and she's with a big fish at her feet, and I painted her with this salmon, having gone salmon fishing. And then, so these are all descendants, but in the case of the sauna, I was working on it, and somebody stopped by and introduced himself and said his name was Lauri Riisinen. Hopefully I pronounced the last name right, Lauri, if you hear this. And he's a Finnish descendant, direct descendant, but from another area. I believe his family was from Canada. But he's Finnish and lives here now, and he makes saunas. And he gave me all the advice that I needed about how to depict this sauna that's right in the middle of the mural. And he told me about the process. You know, you go in, you take off your clothes in the antechamber, and then you go into the second part if it's a big enough sauna to have two parts. And you get the water buckets and the little branches that you slap yourself with, not in a bad way, you know, like to stimulate.
Yeah, you beat yourself with the eucalyptus branches. I've been, there's a Russian spa in the Bayview in San Francisco that I've been to. And
yes,
they do that. They pass out big eucalyptus branches. So, yeah.
Yeah. And then you would go into the inner part and, you know, have your sauna. And he told me there usually would be, if you could have a window, there would be a window because you like to look out on the scenery. So I put a window and put two women in there enjoying the steam from the sauna. And then he said, after you come out, you know, you're really hot. You do that plunge in the creek or in the ocean like you were talking about, if possible. And then you sit and have your hot coffee. And he told me how you sit. You just sit right in front with your legs crossed, relaxing, you know, in this state of bliss. And so I had him model. So he is in there. He is directly portrayed. And then his wife made some pula, and he brought that. And then they both came and visited the mural and saw the portrait and liked it. And the other portrait that I'll just mention really quick, because I met this lady's descendant, is Grandma Katie, and her descendant is one of the local people, Vovo Kane, and she shared pictures with me. So she had all these great pictures of her grandma and told me about her, and she was, you know, so strong-willed, and even though she had bad arthritis, she would walk everywhere and go visit people and had that quality that all the Finns mentioned to me, which is called Sisu. It's S-I-S-U.
And you put that in the mural, right? That's written.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
Yes, it's written in there, and it means a kind of determination, but a calm, non-dramatic determination to get whatever you're trying to do done and to persevere even in the face of adversity. And so I put Vovo Kane's grandma, Katie, in the mural. She's the one serving coffee.
Okay.
Outside of the sauna. But yeah, we should, I can wait for you to ask about it, but Sisu is a big deal.
And yeah, go ahead and ask about it. Go ahead and tell me. I think that you know the next question.
Yeah, they, let's see, let me get back to where I was. I went to read you this. Let's see, where did I write about it? What I wrote in the mural, it has a written sentence at the bottom. I painted the title at the top, and there's other inscription in there, which I like to do because it helps you know what you're looking at. And the inscription that I wrote is, Finnish immigrants valued cooperation, and then there's a footnote, footnote one. So they valued cooperation, social justice, and personal determination. That's footnote two. They worked together for the common good and to build a self-sufficient town. Many supported unions and workers' rights, and they brought the cleansing sauna, which makes bathing a social occasion. And then I got to use the footnotes to put in the two words, Sisu is that trait of determination in the face of adversity, but without making a really big deal about it. You know, you're sort of quietly.
Right. It's there. You have to look it up.
It
you have to know what it is.
Yeah. And the other word, which is one, is called Talkoot, T-A-L-K-O-O-T, meaning work that's done for the common good. And so I put those two footnotes in there so people could read those words.
Once again, I'd like to remind you that you are listening to Be More Now. I'm Blake Moore, and I'm having a nice conversation with local muralist, painter, all-around creative artist, Lauren Sinnott.
It's amazing. Well, I'm looking at the mural right now just to kind of get that feeling. And so the school children, is that a school? Is that a bunch of kids there? Is that what that one
part
of
it is? Know what that is on the left?
Uh-huh.
Okay, so we will look at that.
No, that's actually on the right. It looks like there's on the right, there's a group of kids and
okay, yeah,
adults
on the right
in the back and young people in the front. And then on the left, it looks like a bunch of people outside the hall, maybe marching or something.
So on the right is the whole group of the founders of Sointila.
Okay, and that's that group. Okay.
Yeah, the landscape above.
The community, yeah. It's
yeah.
Very small,
and it's,
And
if I'll mention one other thing right above it, because this is cool and since you're looking at it. In the upper right corner and upper left corner, I painted this symbol, which I had not been aware of before, although after I tell you this story, you guys, well, most of you will have seen it somewhere. So it's a looped square, and I painted a nice fancy version of it in the two corners. And in pre-Christian Finland, it was and continued to be a sign of warding off evil and good fortune. And people would put it on household objects. Like I think the oldest known that I read about was a 1,000-year-old set of skis. And it's, you know, like painted on them. And so the loop square is in there representing this Finnish connection. And then I found out doing this research that Apple adopted the, not necessarily from the Finnish symbol, because it's sort of a well-known wide-ranging symbol, but they adopted the looped square for the command key in 1986. So if you look at your computer, you'll see the looped square. And,
oh, yeah.
And anyway.
Okay. Oh, interesting. That's interesting. That's okay. Uh-huh.
Yeah. And so if you look then at the, so that Sointila is on the right, and on the left, that big hall, this is a really important hall. It's Kalevala Hall, which is now the Lions Club, and it looks, the hall where the Lions meet, it's still there. It looks really different, though. And that one was beautiful. It has, you know, this area where you can stand a little mini roof above it on the top. And anyway, it was built in 1895 by the Finnish Temperance Society. It's at 430 Redwood Avenue. But again, if you look at the mural and go looking for it, you'll never find it because it got changed so much. But the Temperance Society, you know, at this time that was big in our country. And this branch in Fort Bragg built this hall, and they did things there. Like they didn't just say, you should not drink. They wanted to provide something, and they they were trying to provide for an alternative for all these timber workers, especially, or you know, people who had all these physical jobs and didn't necessarily have a home life or were married. And so the only thing to do after your hard day's work was go to a saloon, and you tended to get drunk, and then you'd wake up hungover, and then you'd just go back to work. And so they wanted to provide something more, and they would do concerts and plays, and they had, you know, like a library and a reading room, and held events. And they also had a boarding house where you could live if you wanted to be, you know, have a more moderate lifestyle. But it then, you know, then our country adopted prohibition, and so I think they sort of, I mean, I'm reading into this, but they may have thought their work was somewhat finished. But before I leave that topic, if what I painted was the Temperance Society, and that's that giant group of people. They're small, but there's like 50 people in that group with a little toddler in front. That's the Temperance Society members. And then the hall became Kalevala Hall, which was dedicated to preserving Finnish heritage in America and did, you know, all of these great things for their members and to help out the community. And so that's what that one is. And then if you look at next to it, another important thing, and this was a classic example of how a mural like this about history can get better as you meet people. So, you know, I thought, I already have four big buildings in this. There's a lot of architecture. This is just a several-month project. You know, I can't just go on and on. So I was sort of thinking, okay, we're going to have these two groups, these buildings, the sauna, the inscriptions, et cetera. But I met one of the member Finnish descendants, Paul Nyland, and he is a member of the Lutheran Church. And he said, he told me, I think he said at some point, you got to put that in there. And so I managed to add it, pretty small, but it's way over to the left on the other side of the doorway. But it's appropriate because it's right underneath the depiction of the snowy Finnish, you know, the snowy landscape, the snow forest in Finland, which is painted on the upper left. And the reason it's appropriate there, I think, not just that heritage, you know, and continuity, but there's a saying in Finland that the forest is the church. And that feeling, you know, that sense of the spirit of the land and everything you could take from that. And so I was happy to put the actual Lutheran church that they built right under it and next to it, you know, preserving that connection. So I got to add it. I got to surprise Paul. I told him, you have to come see something. And I filmed the whole thing. It's on the website. And he came, he comes up, and he loved it, but he didn't act very surprised. And I said, Paul, what the heck? And he said, I guessed. When you told me you had something to show me, I guessed what it was. But he was really happy. Yeah, and so there's yet another building in there.
We're getting close to running out of time, believe it or not. But have you done an unveiling? Has there been a celebration there? What is going to happen to present it to the community?
Good question, Blake, because we didn't. You know, I finished on Halloween. It was getting cold, and then the winter. We wanted to wait until warmer weather and try to, you know, not be so rushed. Get the word out. Get as many of these family descendants as possible to come. Because people love it, especially the descendants, you know, just that recognition of this major thing that happened, which is so integrated into the community that you don't see it anymore.
Right.
So, yes, so thank you for asking. And I would, as soon as we figure out when, I'll let you know, and hopefully we could help publicize that, and I invite people to look at the website, even send me an email if they want to, like, be more connected. I'm trying to figure out ways I can do this better, but I want to get the word out when that happens, in the later spring?
Later spring, yeah, that makes sense. So we'll look for that. You let me know, and I'll be happy to announce it on the show also.
Yeah.
So we have some warning so people know, so that'd be great. Can you mention the website one more time so
absolutely
people can go and look at this?
Yes, it's easy to remember. I'm so lucky I got this URL. I just got this like 2 years ago, historymural.com. I'm amazed it wasn't taken. So historymural.com, and that's where you see my giant Ukiah history piece. But the menu will guide you to the finished mural. And if you want me to say it, it's historymural.com/finn, F-I-N-N,
okay,
slash. And that'll take you to all the finished stuff.
Okay, great.
So where is the location of the mural? One more time, it's on Franklin, the 300 block between what and what?
Yes, it's North Franklin, which is the street that's parallel to Highway 1, which is in Fort Bragg is Main Street. So one street east parallel is Franklin, the 300 block of North Franklin, right in the middle of the block. If you see Racine's Art Supply Store, look across the street, and you'll be looking down the little alleyway where the mural is.
All right. Well, I'm going to go make a trip. My next trip to Fort Bragg, I'm going to go look for that mural. I really look forward to seeing it. I just love the work that you've done in Ukiah, and I can't wait to see. Do you have another one planned? Is there a new one already in the works?
Yes. Actually, there's a family in Fort Bragg. I was contacted by a woman, and I guess Julie Shafsky, and she wants to have a mural painted on one of the buildings either that her family used to own or still owns downtown. They were a major family in Fort Bragg that came from Moldova originally, and she loved my work, and I'm going to work with her to do a mural that depicts something of their family history. And so more of a private commission, but it's going to be public. It's, you know, also about the heritage of Fort Bragg. And the other one in Fort Bragg that I want to do is in that the mural I just told you about has a doorway in it, and it has nothing on it, and I can paint it. And what I want to paint on there is, I've gotten permission, is it's smooth. The rest of the wall is all rough. The nice smooth doorway would be the perfect place to paint a double portrait of these two brothers who were the Nelson brothers, who were raised, you know, direct descent. Their parents were immigrants from Finland, and the names get changed a lot, you know. Anyway, they changed theirs to Nelson. And they were very socialist-oriented towards workers' rights and all of that politically, and they took two very different paths. One brother stayed in the area, became a reporter, and, you know, like did wallpapering to earn money, but was a reporter and a historian. And the other brother went to Russia to be part of the communist revolution and went to that part of Finland part of Russia that's right next to Finland that's basically like part of Finland. And he wanted to be part of that. And years later, the family he stopped writing, you know, and they didn't know what happened to him. Years later, they found out he'd been murdered by Stalin. And so it's just this story of two brothers, whole family's devotion to egalitarianism, but how it led into two very different directions. So I'd love to paint their portraits on that wall, on that door.
Very cool. Well, thank you, Lauren. I really appreciate you giving us this time today, and I look forward to the next installment.
Yes, thank you so much, Blake. Thank you for helping me get the word out.
Oh, well, thank you for all the beauty and work you do on behalf of the arts in our county. You really are a treasure. So thank you, Lawrence, and it's wonderful to talk with you.
Thank you, Blake.
And there you have it, Lauren Sinnott on Be More Now. That was a great conversation, and be sure and go check out the From Finland to Fort Bragg mural that Lauren just completed there on Franklin Street in downtown Fort Bragg. And you can check out my website, bemoreyou.net, and go to the musing section, and there will be a link to the show. And you can also find this show on Spotify and, of course, on the KZYX jukebox. And I'm really glad you guys tuned in tonight. I want to let you know that coming up tomorrow night, same time, we have Pride Radio Mendocino at 7 p.m. Friday, we've got Corporal Sen and Terry for an hour of news and music from Mendocino County's LGBTQ community. That's Pride Radio Mendocino, and it's alternating Fridays at 7 p.m. right here on KZYX and Z. And this show, Be More Now, is always on the first Thursday of the month. And stay put right here, because up next we have Debbie Dan and the Treehouse, always a wonderful show. I was looking through the community calendar also and found this event in Willits at the Willits Firehouse from 4 p.m. to 7 p.m. on Sunday, February 5th. And that's supported by the Willits Economic Localization, the WELL Group, building community and open meeting to develop ideas and projects for a sustainable Willits community, housing, local food, health, and more. Diverse groups and individuals comparing what they're working on, their goals for the future, exchanging information, and finding ways to collaborate, a kind of a cross-pollinization. Bring a potluck dish to share if you can, and they say come even if you don't have one. For more information, contact Jane McCabe, and that's JaneMcCabe 1944@gmail.com, or you can call at 707-540-3802. And I guess that's about it for the evening. I thank you all so much for tuning in, and have a beautiful, beautiful evening. I'm going to take us out with a little bit of music. This song crossed my path just the other day, and I've been finding myself wanting to play it first thing in the morning and singing along. It's by Keefness and Rashawn. It's a beautiful day. This is for your day tomorrow.
I don't wanna act too high and mighty, cause tomorrow I may fall down on my face. Lord, thank you for sunshine, thank you for rain, thank you for joy, thank you for pain. It's a beautiful day, it's a beautiful day. Lord, thank you for sunshine, thank you for rain.
Thank you.